This past Sunday night on the Vegas Strip, there was a mass shooting, as I'm sure many of you have heard. It's being called the biggest mass shooting in modern American history. 59 were left dead. Over 500 more were left injured to a varying degree, whether that was from gunfire or from being trampled or hurt in the chaos that ensued after people realized what was going on. The gunman, who was firing from a 32nd floor window, was found dead by the SWAT team who busted in the door. It's being said that he took his life in the end. Now, the theme I was originally going to focus on today in my series on Disney and the Bible was Cinderella and how she teaches us to forgive. And in light of this tragedy, I have to wonder if maybe this is still the message that people need to hear during these dark times. In times like this that are filled with anger, hatred, fear, we need messages of love, hope, and peace. And who better to deliver that message than Cinderella, a true classic in the Disney kingdom, and also one of the best teachers of forgiveness that I have ever known. I say that because for the majority of her life, Cinderella was enslaved by her stepmother and her stepsisters. We get to the end of the movie where she has finally courted the prince, where the prince finally knows her name. And he is madly in love with her. And as I can attest from being head over heels for my own princess, love makes you do things you normally wouldn't do. It makes you have that desire to do anything and everything for that special someone. So Cinderella has that advantage. All she has to do is tell the prince to throw them in jail, or to torture them, or even to kill them, and it would be done, potentially. But she doesn't do that. What she does instead is she forgives them. She doesn't physically say, "I forgive you," at least not on screen. But she lets them be. They get to live in the same house that they have always lived in. They get to live just as lavishly as they have always lived. They get to associate with the same people that they have always associated with. Nothing has changed, except she's not living there anymore. And so we have this great example of forgiveness. Something that we find everywhere in the Bible. We can look exclusively to the readings that I've given today. Matthew 6. This is Matthew's rendition of the Lord's Prayer. We get another one in the book of Luke that is not as commonly used, but in both cases, we have this phrase, "Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors." Followed by an explanation that if we do not forgive other people, God cannot forgive us. But if we can forgive others, then we can have forgiveness from God. And this is an important line also because it touches on the other passage that I read today, and having read this passage a few weeks ago and having given a sermon on that same topic. It's the parable of the unforgiving servant. A master forgives his servant a debt, but that servant cannot forgive the debt of his fellow servant. And as I mentioned a couple weeks ago, again, there needs to be some level of reciprocity. As God forgives, we need to forgive. God sets this great example not just to look good, but so that we might take that example. But these two passages I've read today are not the only examples we have. We can look at literally anywhere in the Bible. The entire New Testament is filled with examples of God forgiving our sins, of Jesus either forgiving sins in life or his atoning sacrifice being the forgiveness of our sins for now and for forevermore. We can look deep into the Old Testament, to the beginning of time. A prime example would be Jacob and Esau. Jacob stole Esau's birthright. So Jacob got everything that should have been his brother's. And in response, Esau threatens Jacob's life, hunts him down until eventually he loses the scent, for lack of a better phrase. Eventually, after having married Rachel and Leah, Jacob returns home, still fearing that Esau harbors this vengeful spirit, that Esau will still want to kill him. But that's not the case. When Jacob gets home, Esau runs up to him, gives him a hug, says, "Welcome home. Here, have some of this land so that you can cultivate it as you wish. Here, meet my wives. I want to introduce you to my children. Look how bountiful my flocks and my livestock and my crops have been." We can move on to that next generation. We can look at Joseph and his brothers. Joseph's brothers originally wanted to kill him. They threw him in a well and were going to leave him there. But they later decided, no, we'll sell him into slavery. But still, his brothers stole his coat. They tore it to shreds. They covered it in blood to deceive their father into thinking that Joseph had been mauled by some wild animal. And later on down the road, once Joseph had ascended the ranks and was second only to Pharaoh in terms of power, his brothers came to Egypt begging for food. And having all of that power, he could have said, "Guards, kill them." And there would not have been a single question asked. But that's not what Joseph did. Joseph revealed himself to his brothers. He wept out of joy of seeing them. He embraced them. He invited his brothers to, "Please, go get our father. Bring him here. Live with me. Eat of our food." And these are just a few examples. But most important of all, though, is what forgiveness has granted in every one of these cases. In every one of these cases, forgiveness has meant freedom. Before Joseph forgave his brothers were imprisoned by guilt for what they had done. Before Esau had forgiven Jacob, Jacob feared for his life every single day. Before the master forgave the servant in the parable, the servant feared for what would happen should he not be able to pay the debt when called upon. And before God forgave our sins through Christ's sacrifice, we were imprisoned by our sin, unable to escape it. But then there was forgiveness. Those shackles, those bars, whatever image you want to use, were broken. And we were set free. Joseph's brothers were no longer held captive by their guilt. Jacob was no longer imprisoned by fear for his life. The servant was no longer afraid of what would happen if he couldn't pay the debt. And we are no longer prisoners of sin. And we find that same powerful image, that same powerful act in Cinderella. When given the opportunity to get revenge on her stepmother, on her stepsisters, she doesn't do it. Just like Joseph, Esau, the master, just like God, she has the opportunity to cause great harm or damage to her stepmother and her stepsisters for what they have done. But just like Joseph, Esau, the master, just like God, she chooses to forgive them instead. She releases them from fear of what will happen when she marries the prince. And I realize that I'm talking about forgiveness as if it's this thing that's easily granted, as if it can happen at a moment's notice. But I know this is not the easiest thing to do. I know this is not the case. When you or someone you love is hurt, whether that's physically, emotionally, spiritually, whatever way you want to choose, you have this innate desire to want to get revenge, to hurt that person or those people. It even says in the Old Testament, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. Relating it to last Sunday, there are some people who would argue that this has happened. That, well, this man killed a bunch of people, he hurt a bunch of other people, and he's now dead. Justice has been done. Others will argue that, no, this is not the case. These people were not shown justice, and he will not face justice. He will not spend a single moment in the court system. Justice has not been done. And there are still others who are processing this, who don't even know which side they will eventually take. And in that same way, God could say, well, okay, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. You have done me great harm in all of the bad that you have done. Therefore, I will do great damage to you as well. But God doesn't do that. Jesus doesn't do this. Jesus' followers don't do this. No one that I've talked about today does this. They might have wanted to at one point, but even if they did, that vengeful spirit, that desire to cause harm, eventually passed away and was replaced by mercy and forgiveness. In short, it was replaced with love. I say that because forgiveness comes not out of necessity, but out of love. Not having love leaves room for hatred to be learned. And I say learned because hatred is not a natural human response. In an episode of Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, he goes to a local school and asks, in light of a shooting that had happened at that point, he asks children, why do you think a person becomes a murderer? And a child responds to say, maybe they're lonely. And he replied, well, why do you think they're lonely? And she replied, because they have no one to talk to. Another girl sitting next to her said, maybe the person they killed was the one who killed someone in their family. I think that speaks volumes. If we are not forgiven, we cannot learn to forgive. If we do not feel loved, we learn to hate that much easier. Hate is the root of events like this past Sunday. It's the root of events like Orlando and Charlottesville. It's the root of the groups that convened in Charlottesville. And I do not claim that forgiveness is the cure, that once everyone forgives, that these things will stop happening. But it is one of the tools to fixing the problem, and it is a major step in the right direction. Perhaps with forgiveness and love taught more readily, not just through word of mouth, but through action, future events like Vegas, Orlando, Charlottesville, and others can be prevented before the seed is even planted. Again, forgiveness is not easy, and I know this personally. When I was 10, my grandmother was murdered, the Tuesday before Easter of all days. And I didn't really even know her, which I think was the major thing that I hated most. That man took that opportunity away from me. And it took me years to forgive her murder. And even then, it was very hard. But still, no one ever said that it would be easy. As the saying goes, all good things come in time. And all good things take work. That includes forgiveness. Once, we didn't have forgiveness. Now, we do. Once, we were condemned. Now, we are saved. The only thing that has changed between forgiveness and not having it, between condemnation and salvation, is that God forgave us. So if forgiveness is the difference between salvation and condemnation, the difference between freedom and imprisonment, the difference between prevention of events like this and the recurrence of events like this, wouldn't you want to put forth the effort to forgive and in return to be